A low malty mitochondrial peat stacks. Yes. And thank you to Jonathan Barshaw for that malt mention, introducing Whisky Review 390, which is part of a prolonged number of reviews on upmarket American bourbons. I have them all, and well, bourbons and other whiskies, other American whiskies. I have them stacked along the shelf behind me so that you can see what's coming next. And what have we got here? Rowan's Creek. Rather an empty bottle, by the way, because I must thank Smiley Pete and Andy Bell at Inverarity 121, who are a basement wine shop in Bath Street, Glasgow, because they put on a bourbon tasting, and I bought a ticket and went along to learn a little bit more about bourbon before I started to present these reviews. Now, you don't get it all right. In the last review, 389, I suggested that Bernheim wheat whiskey was 100% wheat, and it's not, it's 51% wheat, and the rest is made up of corn and barley. But there we go. If I do make any mistakes, malt mates, I'm going to stick my hands up and say, correct me if I need corrected, and I will annotise the corrections to ensure that these vlogs are more accurate. Onwards and upwards. Let's see how accurate we can be with this, because this bottle at the end of the tasting was donated to me with a little drop at the bottom, because I quite enjoyed it, by Andy and Pete as part of their bourbon tasting evening. It's always good, whatever your favourite drink is, whatever you're drinking, however you drink it, to not get too stuck in a rut, even if that rut happens to be a particularly good quality rut. It's always good to refresh your senses and to change direction and to experience something new. And I've been on and off with bourbons for a wee while, but I really wanted, this is an opportunity for me to update myself, upgrade my experience. And having asked around quite a number of malt mates and assorted liquor friends, these were what were brought to my attention. Rowan's Creek is an interesting one. It's in the same stable as Noah's Mill. They kind of have a lot in common, and basically they are non-age statement bourbons of a better quality, hence the higher price. And they tend to come from lower down the racks in the warehouses. So imagine great big freestanding barns, the size of which you could store combine harvesters in them, except they're full of barrels. And the barrels at the top of the barns, they get the heat of the sun through the roof. So that, and they get the cold of the night air through the roof as well. So the fluctuation in temperature tends to be quite drastic at the roof of the warehouse, roof level. But if you go down 15, 20, 30 feet from the 15th rack of barrels to the first and second rack of barrels, the temperature tends to be much more even. So it's a bit cooler during the day and it's a wee bit warmer during the night. Hence, you get a more sustained, even style of maturation, and this is what tends to get bottled as the non-age statement brand craft bourbons. So here it is, Rowan's Creek, straight Kentucky bourbon whiskey, made, they say, and bottled by hand in small lots, whatever small lots mean. You know, small lots can mean anything, to be honest. One batch at a time. It would certainly be a lot more useful to whiskey drinkers if small lots became bottled 5 barrels at a time or 10 barrels at a time. Specific information, because we're now entering an age, really, in whiskey appreciation globally, where there's a small minority of very discerning whiskey drinkers who are, in fact, primarily through the whiskey clubs, through visiting distilleries and through online activity are very much opinion formers. And by the way, malt mates, the industry know it. This is bottled at 50.05%. Now, that immediately elevates the quality simply because you've got stronger alcohol, higher volume of alcohol in the bottling immediately means more opportunity for flavour chemicals to be bonded to the alcohol and for you simply to have more flavour. For something at 50%, it's remarkably mellow on the nose, sniffing the glass. What I'm getting is something sweet, mild wood citrus, toffee, certainly toffee, stewed tea, bitter tannins, banana, papaya, sultana. So we're getting a kind of fresh and dried fruit notes. Cola, quite a common feature of bourbons, fennel and sour apricots with buttermint. Yeah, there's a slight, almost Danish butter, to be honest. Don't want to overanalyze, but there's certainly a mintiness here. This, incidentally, is batch 12.75 and is featured, basically, the information I'm picking up online is approximately 12 years old. It is certainly straight bourbon and certainly very much in the traditional style. With the citrus notes that I'm picking up in the nose, I get the impression there's a little bit of sour mash content, but it's not strongly featuring, it's not challenging the sweetness that you get from commercial corn. Basically, high yielding yellow corn, that's what I would describe as commercial corn. Taste wise, oh, neat. Sweet, burning, nipping alcohol. Quite intense in the sweetness. Excuse me a second. I forgot to fill my water jug. Never mind, I'm just going to have to improvise. Have I got any other sources of water here in the bothy? No, I don't. Damn it. And I'm not going to start re-recording this video. We're going to have to pretend malt mates, okay? No water. I'll have water for the next review. So I'm going to... This is kid on water. One, two, three. All right, now I've added 3 spoonfuls of water. And as you can see, not much change. When you add water, it's very prudent to give high strength spirits at least 5 minutes to settle down and open up, because when you initially taste high strength spirits, which 50% alcohol, after you've added water, it basically, the initial experience is one of, well, basically it's just water added and diluted the high strength and that's it. But it's after 5 to 10 minutes you will notice that the profile of the liquor changes. It kind of, the whole delivery in the nose changes. The array of chemicals that are coming out, or flavour responsible chemicals that are coming out the glass, it does change the character, and it can be quite considerable. What you're looking for is to add just enough water that you've got the maximum smell, maximum flavour, without any loss of the power and the impact of what you're drinking. So, now that we've sort of hypothetically added water, I'll go to my notes for this. Intense, fruity, wood pulp tannins. A really quite an almost sour fudge note. Raisins, Guyanan rum, so we're getting quite a kind of syrupy rum note, molasses, funnily enough, treacle, cinnamon rock, clove, and the honey comes through. Honey is quite a prominent addition once you've added some water to this, along with a certain amount of wood sap. which, to be honest, isn't really doing any favours here. It suggests that the casks used have not been prime prepared. And by that I mean prime prepared casks, best quality casks, are made from wood staves which have been air conditioned over several years to reduce the volume of water in the wood after harvesting and to retain the maximum quality of the flavours and the interaction of the spirit that comes from the wood. The majority of casks used for making bourbon now are kiln cured. So basically within a few weeks of harvesting they're put through what is more or less a baker's oven to drive out the extra water. But unfortunately, with the wonderful smell you get around these places, well, unfortunately a lot of the flavour contributing chemicals that are in the wood, they're driven off with the heat. So a better quality of cask has got a, basically it costs more and takes more time. It's more professionally coopered as well, which is important to note, because when you get leaking casks due to poor cooperage, when the liquor's dripping out, the air's getting sucked in to the cask to replace what's leaking. Therefore, oxidization inside the cask speeds up the more air is drawn in through losses due to leakage. I'll come back to this later. But it's something that you're looking for in good quality bourbons is the presence of good quality casks, and that is not always the case. And one of the signs of a less well prepared cask is kind of sappiness, green sappy woodiness, the sort that you'll experience if you just stick a piece of plain oak into the whatever spirit you're drinking without actually baking it in the oven. Marks out of 100 for Rowan's Creek. It's not bad bourbon. I wouldn't call it top flight, far from it, but it's a good example of a better quality bourbon, but you don't want to be paying too much for it. It does give a certain amount of provenance in the back label. Incidentally, for you American malt mates, if you're wondering what this little pink sticker is, that, if you ever see that in a bottle of whiskey, it means it's been brought out from Britain, because that is the duty paid stamp that's stuck on bottles of whiskey that are produced and sold in the UK. And as you see, it has a UK on it, and then there's a serial number underneath confirming duties paid. Banks don't pay their taxes, but distillers have to pay the duty, and a hell of a lot too, says me getting all political for a moment. So there we have it. That is a bourbon mark. Bourbon mark, 84 out of 100. Something about this which is bugging me is a wee statement down here at the bottom of the label. It says, distilled in Kentucky, fine. I would expect that to be the case. Bottled by Rowan's Creek Distillery, Bardstown. Why doesn't it say distilled at Rowan's Creek Distillery if it's Rowan's Creek Bourbon? Why doesn't it say that? Well, you know, so many of us, when we drink bourbons or quality spirits, we're often at home because they're so damn expensive in bars. You've got to be careful. You know, when they're perceived as fashionable, the bar culture steps in, and often the prices can get well hiked beyond the value of what they actually represent. So, to be honest, thank goodness for whiskey clubs and bourbon clubs. But something is bugging me is, why are they saying bottled at Rowan's Creek Distillery? Because it's easy to find out online. You just put in a Google search, where is Rowan's Creek Bourbon made? Well, it's made at Kentucky Bourbon Distillers, whom also make Noah's Mill, Willett's, Corner Creek and Johnny Drum. So what you have, and a lot of the big bourbon distillers do this, is you have one big distillery producing lots of separate brands which look nothing like each other, and essentially they're using whiskey from the same source. They're using bourbon from the same source. And then they say it's bottled at such and such, you know, the Rowan's Creek distillery. Well, you know, it kind of makes me wonder, do they have, at the distillery where it's produced, do they have little bottling plants that they have a, if one morning they're bottling Noah's Mill, they put up the Noah's Mill sign above the door. And if the following day they're bottling Rowan's Creek, then they pull down the Noah's Mill and pop up the Rowan's Creek. You know, it's, why not be honest, bottled by Kentucky bourbon distillers. We can deal with that. When you see this this information, there's nothing illegal about it, by the way, but it's a bit of smoke and mirrors. It's a little bit of sleight of hand going on here. It's a little bit, to be honest, it's perceived as misinformation. And misinformation reduces the reputation of a brand. And furthermore, when it's repeated across the board by different distillers, it starts to reduce the integrity of the reputation of a particular liquor industry. So, you know, bottom line, honesty and being upfront is damn good marketing. I rest my case. This is an opportunity, actually. I've got an envelope here. Look, lovely stamps. And I've been using this envelope to mark down a few of your comments that have been coming in. Now, first comment is from Vincent Carrido, who mentioned to me in a comment that I didn't initially notice any age statement in Jim Beam Bourbon. But see if you go around the side and look at the red writing, which isn't so easy to read as the black writing. It says 4 years. So, just to confirm, Jim Beam White Label is 4 years old. If, by the way, Vincent goes on to say that any bourbon less than 4 years old must carry an age statement. So there we go. I didn't know that. I knew that every bourbon over 2 years old can be called straight bourbon. But perhaps further definitions and clarifications would help the emerging sophisticated liquor customer. Something else that got mentioned to me was from Josh Wells, who's Australian. Now, this is going to be interesting because I don't think a lot of people in America know that this happens, but Josh is telling me, and I've had further comment from a commentator in New Zealand, that the bourbon, some of the bourbon they get is bottled at 37% volume. So it's bottled at 74 proof, American proof. Now, by law, bourbon in the United States cannot be bottled below 40%. But if it gets shipped across to other parts of the world, well, it isn't bottled in the United States anymore. Therefore, they can add colourant, right? And don't have to mention it. Therefore, they can reduce the strength to 37% instead of 40. Would be illegal in the United States. Wouldn't be acceptable. There'd be a real outcry about it. And quite right too. But this appears to be what they're doing in Australia. So what I did, I went to, I kind of just contacted a few of my malt mates in Oz, and they said, well, they've seen similar things. And they also said, because it's at 37%, they don't bother buying bourbon because they'll get the scotch at 40%. Bourbon industry, take note. It's a global village now. Everybody who wants to know can know because of the internet. Thanks for watching, Malt Mates. I hope you've enjoyed this little review. Join me again shortly when we'll be on to Whiskey Review 391, and it'll be that one in the fancy bottle. I wonder if the contents are fancy. Well, I'm not going to give you any spoilers. You'll have to come back and watch these reviews to find out. See you soon.